Any questions? Oh, go on. Okay, I'll fire one off. I was just rather intrigued, but just that last point I was making about the difficulty of reading a face in a portrait of 200 years ago. But of course, this is true of almost any face. And we've noticed several examples in this afternoon's presentations. The way in which Kathleen Scott, for instance, chose to be photographed, dressed to the nines, never actually up to her elbows in clay, which must have been her real life. And the one that I just wanted to ask about was the photograph of Vanessa Bell with, I think it was Julian or Quentin, one of the two, possibly both, on her lap. And I've rarely seen anyone look so oppressed in all my life. And do we think, in the case of Vanessa Bell, is there a reaction to the process of being photographed? Or is that because she hates being photographed? Or do you think there's something going on there about hating being photographed with children? That's one for Samantha, sorry.
I speak as someone who hates being photographed myself, so I can kind of sympathise with it. I think there was a division in Belle's life between her art and her family, and I think the way we look at it now is that it was purely her family that she responded to. Like I said in my first quote, she was unsure how she'd be practically as a parent, so I think she did come from a strict Victorian upbringing. Her father and her mother, as you said, was a renowned beauty. So I think there was some kind of conflict between the way she was brought up and the way she tried to live her adult life as free-spirited, and I don't think necessarily posing as Mummy Dearest kind of came as naturally to her as maybe it might have done, or that might be just the way we look at it now with the hindsight of knowing what she, you know, how she ended up living her life.
I know, I'd love to see a neuro portrait of that particular photograph. I think it would be extremely interesting. And if I can carry on, unless someone is willing to dive in. Oh, go on, please, Wendy.
I think one of the interesting questions around that photograph is who took the photograph?
Yeah.
Because quite a lot of those defining early photographs of Vanessa Bell were photographs that she took of herself using a timer. So it may have been, because I looked at that photograph and thought, gosh, that looks like a depressed woman. But she may have been leaning down to attend to the timer that took the image. I don't know.
And of course, we never know. That's exactly the point, isn't it? It's so hard to know. There's a great danger there in projecting onto photographs and works of art, I suppose. You may be interpreting, but on the other hand, in terms of engagement, you would argue differently, Louise, wouldn't you?
Yes. In terms of creating a neuro portrait based on that, I mean, I think it's really interesting. I've thought a lot about the project I've just talked about, and maybe, you know, projecting things that you're feeling onto portraits, and is that really what was happening? Are we projecting our own feelings or people's feelings onto those portraits, or were they responding to what was there? And I think there's always a two-way interaction. So what any image you look at, you project onto it things that you feel and you know about, but at the same time, you respond to what you see. So it's a two-way. So your question about her looking depressed and what was going on, that may also tell us something about you.
Let's not talk about me. Do we think that oral histories play their role in actually elucidating this issue? I mean, the whole idea I love that aspect of your project, the Saving Power project, of getting people to talk and using that alongside the imagery and the build-up of the collection at the same time. Is that a really valuable thing that helps us to interpret and engage with objects and visual images?
Yes, I think so. And I suppose I've got my learning and my sort of teacher-educator hat on, you know, because we all kind of come to things from different standpoints. And I think what I found was when the exhibition, particularly at the exhibition at the Black Cultural Archives, when I was working there at the time, we would ask people if they wanted an audio guide to listen to some of the oral histories. And a lot of people said, no, I just want to go round and have a look at the photographs first and then come back and maybe pick up an audio guide. And it's a lot of people who could resonate. They knew they sort of knew the story a little bit. They had a lived experience. So they sort of, they wanted to put their, they didn't want to be, they didn't want to listen to the photographers necessarily or the subjects. They wanted to kind of have their own thinking, and they didn't want that thinking marred. And then they would come back, and because they could pick up an audio guide and then go back in and then listen to the stories. And then there were other people who maybe were younger people or people who were maybe researching who would pick up an audio guide and go in because they might not be so familiar. I'm not saying that's everybody, but what we found was a lot of people who were familiar with the story kind of wanted to see it from their point of view, first of all. And a lot of the events that we ran around, particularly at the Black Cultural Archives, was very much around people telling their story through the photographs because you are engaging with an audience who were discerning. So either because it was intergenerational and a father talking to their son about what was going on there at the time, or somebody who could actually talk about their own or they were there. Lots of people were talking about, well, I was there and I know that person. And people were talking about people that they knew in those photographs because they were local, so that was local to them. And even people who came down from Birmingham and saw, you know, Poga Caesar's bath after the uprisings in Birmingham and saw the flying bath landing on the floor, on the ground, in the street. They were there and would tell you those stories about, oh, it wasn't a race riot. Don't believe them, it wasn't a race riot. It had to do with working class people coming together and saying to the authorities, we're not happy. And so it was different people had their own stories, then brought their own narratives to those images.
The value of a counterpoint. Question over here.
Hello. Hi. I'm speaking from I'm a mental health support worker, and I take people around galleries. And I think both the oral histories and the neuro portraits are fantastic ways of engaging people with the idea about identity, but also about imagery, because the problem with some of the imaging we get is that there is a lot of belief that imagery is meaningful, but I think it is about the experience and the discussion that happens afterwards, as well as being able to relate to that. I noticed in the neuro images that there was a lot of reference to the images that were shown to them in terms of the blue and yellow, and I think that's a wonderful way of projecting our understanding of mental health now back into those days. And so I'm just wondering about how much conversation those images and those exhibitions have brought in the community in terms of understanding the social aspects, because that's what I heard most from looking back at the stories, is seeing that it's not an illness identity that sometimes the neuroimaging pictures would stigmatize people into. A lot of people reject that's a depressed brain or that's a normal brain, and so it becomes stigmatizing as well. But the stories about people's experiences and lives and being able to relate them back to current social situations as well, how much those exhibitions have brought that forward to the communities.
I know that we did have quite a few conversations about that kind of scientific way of talking, and some people were very uncomfortable with it and didn't recognise their own experience, maybe of their own mental health. They didn't recognise that description of it. Certainly, somebody with Asperger's was quite angry about the way that condition was described, the neurological way that was described to him, and actually produced a piece which we didn't show, which kind of was an answer to that and said something very different. But he felt that by creating that piece of art, he had a voice to say something about the condition that maybe people didn't know. We didn't collect evaluation. We didn't have, from the general public. We had a book which people wrote in, but we didn't formally evaluate, so it's hard to say. But I know anecdotally a lot of people that saw the exhibition, and certainly people from Mind came and talked to me about that exhibition and the work. Yeah.
We might have time for one more question, but I know it's, people want to get home probably. If there is anyone else? Okay. Oh, there's one. I saw Twitch. It's too late now.
It's just a really quick question. It's to throw back to to Alice. Thank you so much for your paper and everybody else. It was all fab. But what kind of black portraits and depictions of black people would you like to see? You threw it out to us, and I'd just love really quickly to hear what you would like to see or kind of top tips for us.
Crikey. I think that some of those last images that I showed are really good counterpoints. Some of the images that are in the Staying Power, I think the whole point of, as I kind of understand your session, the whole point of that project was to challenge some of the negative stereotypes that circulate around representations of blackness. So certainly some of the images that we saw today were fantastic antidotes. I guess my question is, in that exhibition, Let the Canvas Come to Life with Dark Faces, it had a whole range of artists working in paint, in print, in graphic, photographic media, and they simply weren't collected. And so I don't know where some of those images are that I showed. I just found them in the catalogue, and I thought, oh, that's amazing. That's an amazing looking painting as far as I can tell, but I have no idea where it is or how to get in touch with the artist. So there's still lots of work to be done in investigating and digging, and I think that's all of our jobs, really. So, yeah.
Okay, I think I will wind proceedings up now. I'd just like to thank all of our speakers, not just this afternoon, but this morning as well. I've had a wonderful day. It's been fascinating throughout. And so my thanks to Caroline, who's just sneaking away at the back there, for a wonderful job she's done organizing. My thanks also to Nick Cullinan for letting us have this day here and for welcoming us this morning. Thank you all, and safe journey home. Thank you.